Good evening, good evening, good evening. As promised, I want to go back and make sure that you have the last three of the five things that should take place if you're in a meeting that's been ordained by God. So I just wanted to give you a few minutes to get yourself together, and we'll be going into our study shortly. I pray that you are anticipating the presence of God this upcoming year, and that you have taken some time to set aside some retreating time to be in the presence of God so that you'll begin to develop a more superior version of yourself. Amen. So we're going to just thank God for this opportunity to be with you this evening. And I'm listening to Byron Cage in the background. Thou art a shield for me. Scripture references Psalm 3. Byron Cage, thou art a shield for me. Let's listen just a little bit. My glory, my lifter of my head. Yes, hallelujah. Hallelujah. Love and a strong mind. Yes, God. Yes, hallelujah. He's a shield for me. The glory, the lifter up of my head. Hallelujah. Thank you for lifting my head far above the circumstances, God. He keep our minds in perfect peace because our minds are stayed on him. Amen. Hallelujah. Glory be to God. So today, we're going back over the five things that validate that a meeting has been ordained by God. If you saw the first video, I put it out on YouTube. You can refer back to that in Sisters Made of Clay, the December meeting that we had. We did record that video. So it is available on YouTube for your convenience to be able to go back and catch up on those first two things we talked about. Encounters, and we talked about transformations. And today we're going to go into 3, 4, and 5. So before we do that, we're going to have a word of prayer. And so we just want you to gather yourselves in and just prepare to go before the Lord. Father, we just thank you. We glorify your name. God, you're so good to us, and we do thank you, Father, because you have kept us all throughout all of the situations going on in the world. God, you're above the circumstances, and you have lifted us above the circumstances as well, as long as we keep our eyes and our minds stayed on you and your word. So, Father God, as we delve into another portion of the things that you have ordained for a meeting, we just ask that your presence be among us on today, Lord God. Oh, God, for the those that will be listening and looking at this video, Father, we just pray that you will give them ears to hear, a heart to receive, Lord God, and my God, a spirit to contain everything that has been, that will be spoken on today. Father God, we thank you right now for your Holy Spirit that leads and guides us into all truth. And Father, we thank you for the transformation work that the Holy Spirit does as we yield to him. Father, we praise you. Thank you for this day, and thank you for this new year that's coming up. Father, we don't take lightly that you've allowed us to come to this place in this time, Father God. And Lord, we want to be the very best that we can be for who you have called us to be and for what you have called us to do. So Father, we give your name glory. We give your name all praise and all honor. It's in your son Jesus' name we pray. Amen and amen. Hallelujah. Amen. So we talked about in our last meeting, I'll go over them very briefly. Number one, encounter. An encounter is a name given to a spiritual experience that creates conviction. So when you've had an encounter with God, it deepens your faith in Him. It deepens your conviction of whatever it is that you believe or that you have received as a revelation from God. And we did have some examples of that in the first video recording that we did for that meeting in December. The next thing that we have is transformations. Now, transformation is the name given to the process that makes you become like Christ. You have to have a process. It's not about going and sitting up in the church from one service to the next, from one meeting to the next. You must hear the word of God, and the word of God is what transforms you from the inside out. Okay, so the ability to become like Christ in experience through sound communication, that is an explanation or an interpretation of the scriptures. That's why we have apostles, prophets, evangelists, pastors, and teachers, so that we'll be able to submit to the sound teaching and the explanation of the word of God that is broken down into a form that we can become metamorphosed by that word. That word is what changes us. 2 Corinthians 3:17. Now the Lord is that spirit. There are so many spirits, but the Lord is that spirit. And where his spirit is, there is liberty. There's a transformation that takes place. Okay. So once that experience is for all people. And then to Romans 12 and 1 and 2, Paul said to the Romans, that he's asking them to present their bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable. Once you receive your transformation, now this is to the brethren, you know. So this is that you not be conformed to the thinking patterns of this age, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. The word of God is what renews your mind. So when you come into the faith or the belief where you're going to be discipled by the word of God, you don't follow your mind anymore. You don't do what you feel like is the right thing to do anymore. You submit yourself to the directives and the dictates of the Holy Spirit. You submit yourself to Him and His people that He places in your life for counseling. You know, God has to be the one to show you where you belong and who you're to submit to. But ultimately, you submit to God, because we're to obey God rather than man. And if man steps off of the beaten path of teaching the word of God from the Holy Scriptures and explaining it and living it as an example, if they step off of that path, then we're not obligated to sit under those people that are not ministering the word of God and teaching the faith of God that's backed up by the word, the scripture. Because we're in this world, but we're not to be of this world. We are supposed to be transformed by the renewing of our mind. And we know the Holy Spirit is a transforming nature. And so when He lives on the inside of us, He responds to the word and helps us to live that word out so that we represent Christ the best possible way. So transformation was the second thing that should happen when you're in a meeting or if you go to a church. These are the things that should take place, okay? You should have an encounter with God some kind of way, you know. You should receive transformation because of the word that's being ministered. And the third thing that should happen is that you should be able, the Holy Spirit rather, should be able to express Himself in signs, miracles, and wonders. We should all have that experience where the Holy Spirit has showed up in a sign, a miracle, or a wonder. Something has to take place to let you know that He is in operation. Okay. So for number three in my notes here, It says, We talked about the three dimensions of knowledge that should take place when transformation happens in your life as well. I highly recommend that you look at the first video. It's going to be a blessing. Okay, so number three, an opportunity for the Holy Spirit to find expression, okay, in the midst of his people, in miracles, signs, and wonders. St. John chapter 2 and verse 11. Let's go to St. John chapter 2 and verse 11. And let's see what it reads. This is the first miracle that was recorded, where Jesus turned the water into wine. And we're going to read verse 11. Let's see. And I'm reading from the NIV version. So NIV verse 11 says, what Jesus did here in Cana of Galilee was the first of the signs through which he revealed his glory, and his disciples believed him. Now that's key, because this was the first miracle that he did in their midst, in the midst of his people, and his disciples believed him. And that's key, because the Bible says this is the beginning of miracles. Not that it had to stop there or that it stopped there. This was the beginning. And that lets us know that the beginning of the miracles he did in Cana of Galilee was to manifest his glory. Why? Because to the end that the disciples would believe on him. The faith life that we have been called into is a dimension of spiritual reality that can be proven here and now. Jesus is the same yesterday, today, and forever, and the reality of his power, his grace, and his love must find expression in the midst of his people here and now. We must believe in the supernatural. We must believe in the miraculous and the power of God. Okay, so that's miracle signs and wonders. There has to be a space or a place where you experience the miracles, signs, and wonders of Jesus Christ in your life, okay? Because if the miracle stopped at the wedding at Cana, then how are we going to express how God works with miracle signs and wonders to people that may not believe the Bible? They may not believe my testimony, okay? It's a miracle that I'm living my life out of being a female and not a male, okay? Because I was trapped in a lifestyle of lesbianism, and I could have remained with that mindset, but transformation took place, and I no longer have those thoughts, because the transforming work of the Holy Spirit is what comes in, and it changes and reroutes that, because we were all born in sin, all shaped in iniquity. So God has to allow us to go through a transformation so that we can experience change, true change. And when you think about it, you know, we're all born in sin, all shaped in iniquity. It's a miracle when you can even believe that a Virgin Mary brought forth a baby. Not having any experience or intercourse with a male, it's a miracle that a woman can be impregnated and bring forth the Christ child. If you can believe that, that is the greatest miracle that took place to me. And because now we understand that we have to have our own experience where God gives us a miracle so that we know that he is. The miracle in my life may be something different from the miracle in your life. But the thing that makes it a miracle is that it could not be controlled or performed by man. It lets you know that it's something that only God himself could do. There was nothing that man could do. It was out of our jurisdiction, but it needed to be done. Okay, so when you think about a miracle, a sign, or a wonder that God has produced and performed in your life, make notes of that and be ready to share when we come together in January. Our next meeting is January the 15th, 2022. So we're fastly approaching our next meeting time. So we want to make sure that we give you that information as well. Okay, the fourth thing that should take place whenever you're in a meeting, and I like to say with Sisters Maida Clay, God has not failed us. We've experienced the miracle signs and wonders. We have the testimonies of those that have experienced miracle signs and wonders. We have those that have had encounters with God right here in this living room. I mean, God has come in and visited us so many times right here in my own home. And I appreciate the faithfulness of God that as we come together and position ourselves to meet him every third Saturday, he comes and he's faithful to be here with us and to, you know, just stay with us the whole time we experience his presence. And he gives us the confirmation through the word that is taught that it is something that he downloads in our spirit and we can live from that word. So I thank God for that. So, and we have had those that have experienced the transformation, you know, not only myself, that have had the transformation where the word has changed our mind from the sin state to a life of kingdom. You know, there are those that are also here that have experienced transformation where God took our minds off of the things of this world and patterning our thinking off of this age and taught us how to be kingdom minded, because that's what transformation is all about, that you would leave the thinking patterns of this world and become like Christ. And that transformation is a process. So we have experienced that here in Sisters Made of Clay. So impartation is the fourth thing that should take place when you're in a setting or in a group or you're going to services at church. I don't care where I go, I look for these five things, you know, because he said our steps are ordered. So I'm going to make sure that I'm encountering him, that I am being transformed by whatever I'm engaging in. If it's not transforming, I don't have to be there. It doesn't mean anything. And then the miracle, sign, wonders. I look for God to be present because he said he'd never leave us nor forsake us. And I believe it's the time in our lives where God wants to engage and interact with us as much as we would allow him to come in. He wants to be in his people. He wants to dwell among us, showing himself, you know, that he is here and that it's not about all that's going on in the world and he doesn't see it, but he has a people that he has set apart, called and chosen, that will name the name of Christ and that will pull themselves away from this system and be in the world, but not of it. And then begin to produce the power that he said is available to us. Amen. That is the thing that I look forward to, that God would allow me to represent him and demonstrate the power that he has made available to us. So impartation is a mystery. All right. The system of transferring spiritual possibilities from one person to another. Okay. From one person to another and from one region to another. Isaiah 9 and 8. Let's look at Isaiah, the 9th chapter, verse 8. This is a good word, I like using my computer, but sometimes I like to be able to flip in my Bible, but Isaiah 9, verse 8. And it reads, okay, it says, the Lord has sent a message against Jacob. It will fall on Israel. All the people will know it, Ephraim and the inhabitants of Samaria, who say with pride, arrogance of heart, the bricks have fallen down. Is it the same? I'm sorry, excuse me. Isaiah 9 and 8. So every time God invests grace upon one person, it is to the intent that it reaches a people. So Isaiah 9 and 8 says, the Lord has sent a message against Jacob. It will fall on Israel. Okay. So all the people will know it. Ephraim and the inhabitants of Samaria, who say with pride and arrogance, the bricks have fallen down. We will build with dressed stone, the fig trees that have been fallen, but we will place them with cedars. But the Lord has strengthened resin's foes against them and spurred their enemies on. Okay. So he sends a messenger. So impartation is every time God invests grace upon one person, he sent this messenger. He means it to the intent to reach a whole people. So he wanted to reach the nation of Israel. So he sent a message against Jacob, but it's going to fall on Israel. Okay. So you can read and study that in your own time. And I'm sure you can see some other places where God gave an impartation to one person and it was meant for a whole region of people. Okay. So that he sent a word to Jacob, but the intention was that it would light on Israel. So if we look at Romans chapter 1 of Romans, and we're going to start at verse 1. Romans chapter 1, verse 9 through 11. Let's do that. It's 9 through 11. Okay, God, whom I serve in my spirit, is preaching the gospel of his son, is my witness how constantly I remember you. You in my prayers at all times, and I pray that now at last God's will, the way may be open for me to come to you. So this is Paul speaking to Romans, and this is the NIV version. I long to see you so that I may impart to you some spiritual gift to make you strong. That is, that you and I may be mutually encouraged by each other's faith. That's impartation, that we would come together and be encouraged by each other's faith. Okay. So, it's an instructive statement. It takes on more than salvation experience because, you know, it takes more than a salvation experience to be a witness. You must be empowered by the Spirit. And I talked about the ministry of the Holy Spirit a little bit earlier today because you can't do anything without the Holy Spirit. And it's more than just a phenomenon where you just get in a room and everybody's speaking in tongues. And on the day of Book of Acts, you know, when that time came down, the Bible says that they heard them, every man, speak in his own tongue. So it wasn't unknown tongues like that. But the sign was these people were from, say I'm from America and I go over to China and I just began to speak Chinese. Okay. That's an impartation, and that would be God doing that miracle like that. But it's not an unknown tongue. Unknown tongue is a heavenly language. It's a spiritual language. That didn't say that. It said they heard every man speak in his own language. Okay, they spoke with other tongues as the Spirit gave them the utterance. Okay, so the Holy Spirit must empower you. Okay, and that's Acts 1 and 8. But you shall receive power after that the Holy Ghost comes upon you, not to become preachers or politicians or policemen or whatever the office may be or the work that you're going to do. But those things, they just define your geographical assignment. But in the mind of God, all together, we all are witnesses. We're his witnesses. People get caught up in titles. You know, I know we said you have apostles, prophets, evangelists, pastors, and teachers, and those are for the edification of the saints. It's not for you to boast that you are an apostle or that you are a prophet to the nations or that you are this thing, because without the Spirit, you're just that title. But when you have been empowered by the Spirit of God, the Holy Ghost, as he said you would be a witness to him. Okay? You could be an apostle and not be a witness. Because if you are not impacted by the Holy Spirit and you are not changing anyone's life by your witness, not by your title, it's not going to mean anything to the kingdom of God. Because that's what he raised all of us up for, so that we would be witnesses unto him in Judea, Samaria, and the uttermost parts of the earth. We are supposed to witness, okay? And one thing about a witness is a validator of a claim, okay? He said, you will be witnesses to me both in Jerusalem, Judea, and Samaria, and all to the uttermost parts of the earth. This is not limited to just a group of people. Acts 2:39 says, it's also the promises to you and your children and your children's children and those that are far off, and as many as the Lord our God shall call. So when you become imparted, when God imparts into you his word, his wisdom, or he allows you to be in the presence of other people and you get encouragement in your faith from them, you've received an impartation. I think impartation also has a lot to do with intimacy, because you have to be close enough to that person to receive what it is they want to give you. Okay, that's not just close in proximity, but that's close in spirit. Okay, and sometimes it takes developing relationships with people. That's why I believe that when God calls us the body of Christ and the family, and then he said with the body, each joint supplies, okay? All of us have a supply for the other. I know when we're here in Sisters Made of Clay, we've had total strangers to come into our meeting. And when they hear the testimony of each other, they're encouraged. It's like, okay, it sounds just like that person is living my life, you know, and that can only be God, you know, and it happens all the time. We have people that this may be their first time visiting Sisters Made of Clay, and they come in and we start sharing, you know, and we do what we do. And then the Holy Spirit begins to circle around in the room, and whoever is speaking, someone that, you know, maybe just visiting, had never been here before, had never met anyone in here before, and they'll receive an impartation, okay? So that impartation is to help build them in their faith, okay? And to help them be a stronger witness to the things that they have experienced. Because I believe our testimonies are not to hinder us, they're to embolden us and make us more confident in the God that we have had the encounter with. It's very important that we not only have that one encounter, but that we continue to seek him on a daily basis, and we continue to encounter him, and we long for him, and we seek him. He said, you will find me if you seek me with your whole heart. So that's what God is looking for us to do, to seek after him. As the deer panteth after the water brook, so does my soul pant after you. And so that's one of the things that is so important about prayer, when we need to be in those places where we get in our place and we seek after God for as long as he would beck for us. And then even if he don't beck for us, our hearts should long to be in the presence of God, because in his presence, there's fullness of joy. That's where we get a download of everything that we need, encouragement, strength, you know, whatever it is that we need, healing, whatever we need is found in the presence of God. And that's why the enemy don't want us to get in the presence of God. Even with doing this little video today, before I got started, I was home a couple of hours before and I just could not get things together. It was a matter of this little distraction setting up, or it was this getting over here, or it was this happening over here, till I had to finally look at myself and say, hey girl, you're getting caught up again. You're falling right into the trap. That's what the enemy wants you to do. Stop everything. Take a deep breath. Rewind. And then go into your place of worship. Cleanse your atmosphere and represent yourself to this assignment for today, to get this information out the 31st day of December, so that whenever January 1 comes tomorrow, we can hit the flow running. You know, you have to do these things intentionally. It's an intentional thing. So I pray that you're receiving an impartation, even just as us being together just on this video right now. So impartation was the fourth thing. And the fifth thing is something I love and something I thrive on, is fellowship. The fifth thing that should happen whenever you're in a meeting that has been ordained by God is fellowship. There's a mystery that happens when believers come together under a corporate anointing. We may not be in a church setting, because now with COVID, they have not allowed full services to return back. But what God has done, it's caused us to be able to come together in small numbers. I love small groups. I always have. And the church started in the house. So that's the unique thing about Sisters Made of Clay. And this thing of doing the videos and making them available for people to just be able to embrace from being at home, I believe is a blessing as well. And you can always, you know, write in with your questions, comments, or you can comment right on the YouTube chat. And I will always check those so we can get back with you on that. But it's a unique thing when we come together under this corporate anointing. Psalm 133 and verse 1 says, "Behold, how good and how pleasant it is for brethren to dwell together in unity," to be in that place where we just live together in unity, because it's just like the oil that runs down Aaron's beard. That means nobody gets left off. The oil went down from the head all the way down his beard, all the way down. So it's saturated, you know. So there's a saturation that comes in when we fellowship together, because God makes it where we're all one mind. Because, and that's where the blessing, Psalms 133 and 1 says, "For there the Lord commands the blessings." Okay, Psalm 133. Let me just go there right quick so that I'll make sure that I don't miss anything from that verse. Psalm 133 and verse 1. I'll read the whole thing. It's only three little verses. It says, "How good it is when God's people live together in unity." Again, this is the NIV version. It said, "It's like precious oil poured on the head, running down on the beard, running down on Aaron's beard, down on the collar of his robe. It is as if the dew of Hermon were falling on Mount Zion, my God, for there the Lord bestows his blessing, even life forevermore." Now that's a blessing when we fellowship together. That's why it's so important to keep division from among us, to keep those that don't have the same mind, the mindset that we have, like-minded people. I don't believe in cliques, but I can tell you this. If we're not on the same page and we're not going in the same direction, and it seems as though every time we engage each other, there's friction, that's not unity to me. And that's not descriptive of what Psalm 133 said that we as believers should subscribe to. So I will quickly make an exit. If I don't do it here, I will do it that way. So it doesn't matter if it's a church. It doesn't matter if it's a setting. Now, I'm not rude. I know how to dismiss myself, but I know how to disengage, because at that point, we are sinning, because the Word of God tells us that it is good and it's pleasant when we dwell together in unity. And you know what? I believe that that's a choice and it's a commitment. I believe that God, in these last